more than 1300 crore rupees. In our center, we have NMR, UPLC, HPLC, then all the thermal gravimetric analytical techniques, just like a TGA, DTA, DSC, on and above, air chromatograph, then microwave synthesizer, ultrasound instruments for the dissolution procedure, and so many small and medium-sized instruments we have. Our working staff in our department is 100 students, 50 from the self-finance, 50 from the grant in aid. So this is our brief introduction regarding our department. Right now we are going to the fourth cycle of the NEC. So we are busy almost in the since last 1 month to upload the data of the university. So among these, yesterday I missed the some part of the conferences. Today I am with you. Let me introduce about the our today's speakers. So shall I continue for the introduction of the speaker? Okay. Yeah, sure. So, myself and my students going to be present in this conference one paper. It was regarding the simple, efficient, and eco-friendly methods developed for the synthesis of biological active compounds. So just we are doing some work on the green chemistry also. So here so many facilities. So one of the good microwave synthesizer, ultrasound apparatus is also with us. Over and above, we are using the minimum use of the solvent for the organic synthetic procedure. Here this procedure switch over to also in the analytical chemistry. To reduce the minimize or to reduce the use of the organic solvent and go for the in analytical chemistry concept also. So here in this paper, this is the just highlight of the paper. So we have developed here a efficient and eco content. Yeah. There are only a few slides, not total presentation. Okay. So here is a efficient and eco-friendly method. It is for the biological active compound. It is a 6-acetyl benzoxamine diol, which is prepared by using the microwave irradiation technique. Here, the first of all, the alkylation of the 6-acetyl benzoxamine with the substituted alkyl derivatives under the microwave radiation in presence of the tetra and beta levatin bromide. It is used as a phase transfer catalyst, which provide the desired product. If we compare with the conventional as well as the microwave acetate synthesis. So we are getting the more improved result in case of the microwave acetate synthesis. First of all, increase the yield, increase the purity. So these are the two major goals for any synthetic chemist. So that we are success in these protocols. So whatever the compound we have synthesized, which is characterized, supported by the IR, NMR, C13 NMR, high resolution mass spectroscopy, and further, we have developed a single crystal, and we have already studied for the single crystal XRD technique. So here, these are the some compound whatever we have synthesized. So these are the just compound synthesized correlate with the available compound in the market. So these are the carrageenan, ifaverizine, etifoxin, acetylene. So this type of the moiety we have tried to synthesize till the NTV some activity are under progress. So whatever the our aim of the work, we want to develop the substituted benzoxamine derivative which contain the benzoxamine as a nuclei. We have used here the greener method like the microwave, have synthesized and substituted one the benzoxide derivative with reduced time and improved the products to optimize the reaction condition. All the technique we have used, conventional as well as the microwave, to avoid the hazardous and costly solvent and the reagent, and the reaction is carried out at a normal temperature by using the microwave synthesizer. Later on, we have tried to study the antibacterial activity of the compound. So these are the reaction scheme. Very simple molecule, 2-hydroxybenzamide, react with the acetyl chlorine, convert the one intermediate one, further react with oxalic chloride and toluene, the intermediate two, substituted alkyl or enol bromide, react with this intermediate two, which provide the substituted alkyl or enol benzide, benzyl ketol CO3, 20% mol of TBAB, DMF. So these are the technique. It is a very well known, but we are using not a conventional microwave synthesizer. It is a scientifically available in the market, which are used for the synthetic purpose, where we also digest or distill the gum, or the reflux is also possible in the microwave. So these are the practical condition. What is the difference between the conventional and the microwave technique? It is demonstrated over here. So all the product and the reaction monitor carried out by using the TSD technique. In both the cases, we have monitored the reaction by using the TLC. So these are the optimization of the reaction conditions. So whatever the solvent we are using, a different solvent, among the various solvent, what is the time in the case of micro, in case of conventional heating method? So there is a vast difference. There is a difference in the yield, difference in the time, temperature. So these are the good outcome in the case of a DMF, K2CO3, TBAB, it is the catalyst. So temperature is near about 80 in the microwave. Time is only the 8 minutes, while in case of the conventional, it is a 1 hour. So whatever the yield is there, it is almost 88% to 90%. In case of the conventional, it is only 20. So by using this technique, it can be minimized the use of the various organic solvent, DMF is the water soluble, TBAB is also water soluble, so there is no need to remove the any particular metal is required for the removal of the excess of the solvent. So TBAB is the 20 mol percent, 5 minute time, 92% yield we have got from this microwave condition. And these are the physical constant. We have developed the various derivative by using the same procedure, and these are the various physical data. Varun, hello. So this is the microwave acetate method, and this is the spectra of this compound, which is synthesized under the microwave radiation. So we are getting here the various fragment. Base peak is 105, so we can be easily find out here the 105. The molecular weight is 390. We are getting near about the 390 with M plus 1 peak. So this is the high resolution mass spectrometry of the compound, the BGB05. Whatever the calculated mass is using the M plus sodium, so it is 332.0893. The exact mass is obtained and confirmed by using the green chemistry technique. This is the possible carried out the similarity between the conventional method as well as the microwave. So the factors in the time and yield also. So these are the characteristic data of the sum of the IR spectroscopy. These are the further detail NMR fragmentation or NMR peaks are there. These are the T30 NMR of the compound, TB. So which give the satisfy result with the comparison of the number of carbon. And this is the single crystal XRD analysis. This analysis is carried out in our laboratory because we have this instrument, and we have get a 100% similarity of the theoretical structure as well as the practically obtained structure. These are the some of the MIC of the compound. Still, we have sent this compound for the further activity for the tuberculosis as well as the anti-cancer activity. So from this discussion, we have optimized the condition by using the different solvent, heat transfer catalyst in a variable proportion. TBAB found the suitable catalytic activity without any side reaction, and the quantitative effect of the catalyst varied from the 5 to 25% mole percentage ratio, and the resulting yield up to the 92% we have improved. And all the compound synthesized supported by the various spectroscopy as well as the single crystal XRD technique. Some of the compounds was the good activity for the antibacterial as well as the fungal activity. So we have synthesized 15 compounds by using the conventional as well as the micro methods, and these are the outcome that micro synthesis is the more convenient, more super as compared to the conventional method. But drawback of the micro is it is not implemented up to the industry level. It is useful for good for the laboratory scale preparation only. In the large scale, we are not that much of a success by using the micro artificial reaction. We have get the facilities from the UGC SAP program. We have Center of Excellence, it is called the National Facility for the Drug Discovery, and our department provide the, my university provide the all type of the facilities. But these are the some references, whatever we have taken for the preparation of the compounds. Thank you, everybody. Yeah. It is here. Yeah. Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you. So, can I proceed? Yeah, can I follow it? Okay, okay. So, thank you very much, the convener and the all team of the convener. I am very happy to introduce Dr. Neelu Chauhan. She is working as an associate professor at the Department of the Pure and Applied Chemistry, University of the Quetta. She did her MPhil from the Ajmer and doctorate from the
Hello. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes,
are you getting me?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, thank you so much, sir. Yeah, sir. Thank you so much.
So she did her MPhil from
I feel extremely sorry for disturbing the session because my net connectivity was disturbed. So therefore I feel sorry.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yeah, let me start from very beginning. I am very happy to introduce Dr. Neelu Chauhan. She is working as an associate professor at the Department of Pure and Applied Chemistry, University of Quetta. She did her MPhil from the Ajmer, a doctorate from the Taiwan. Her major research field is the heterogeneous catalysis, oxidation kinetics, and then she has switched over to the surface studies via advanced technique. She has published more than 12 books from the national and international reputed publishers. She published more than 30 research papers. She got the one patent. She has asserted with the number of journals. She has carried out minor and major research projects, more than 5 projects. She guided more than 6 students. She has attended and participated the 78 conferences, national, international. She got the recognition from the teacher research fellowship from the UGC, postdoctoral fellowship from IIMH, academic senior. He is also awarded with the Indian Chemical Society and Chemical Sciences by IOSRD. So with this brief introduction, I would like to invite to Dr. Neeru Chauhan to take over the charge for the your presentation. Thank you. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. So may I take you from you? Okay, thank you. Thank you. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, are you here, ma'am? Are you here, ma'am? Sir, am I audible? Okay, sir. Good afternoon, one and all. After listening to a wonderful session, we are going to invite our next researchers from serial number 19 to 30. They will be getting maximum 5 minutes each to showcase their research and discoveries. Kindly note the names of participants who will present are Kalyawani, Jagrati Meena, Dr. Jagrati S. Shushu, K. Kiran Kumar, Neha Kapoor, Neelam Kumari, Nilanjana Kar, Seema Kothari, Nisha Garg, Poonam Punia, Bagela Forum H, Pramod B. Thakur. All the participants, please write the present in chat box with serial number. Now, I would like to invite Mr. R. Kalyawani from Madurai, Tamil Nadu. Mr. R. Kalyawani.
Hello, ma'am. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Now I have to share the PPT, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Please present, ma'am.
How I have to share my PPT, ma'am?
Hello.
I have to pin my email. Then how I have to share my PPT? Mobile, you know. Sharing option is not functioning, you know, sir. I selected that sharing. Hello.
Can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
Myself, Dr. Jagriti Meena, from JDB Government Girls College, Kota, Rajasthan. Today, my talk is on my second in topics for soil conversion and space. Why we choose the photogalvanic cell? We all know that energy is crucial ingredient that connect to economic, social and environmental development of any nation. The conversion of energy develops environmental problem in term of greenhouse gases emissions. The renewable energy source to appear to be the one of the most efficient and effective solution of environmental problem. We all know that the solar energy is also a renewable energy sources that is clean, non-polluting and free and unlimited for us. So we choose the solar energy in our cell. The photovoltaic cell also use the solar energy to convert electric energy, but the photovoltaic cell are cost effective and weather effective and occupy more space to installation. So we choose our work on photogalvanic cell. Photogalvanic cell is a way of converting the light into electrical energy. The novel approach for renewable sources of energy has led to an increased interest in photogalvanic cell because of their reliable solar energy conversion and storage. We use a material in our work are toluidine blue as a photosensitizer, EDTA as a reductant, and sodium lauryl sulfate as a surfactant. And for alkaline medium, we used sodium hydroxide. All the solution were prepared in double distilled water. We used H-shaped glass cell was used containing known amount of photosensitizer, toluidine blue, reductant, EDTA, and surfactant NaLS. And for alkaline medium, NaOH. The total volume kept 25 ml. First, and a platinum electron was dipped into one limb and the second limb are contained with calomel electrode. All the electrode, both electrode are connected to digital pH meter. First, we placed the whole system in dark and measured the potential till the stable potential was obtained. Then platinum electrode was exposed to a 200 tungsten lamp. We used their artificial light source. The water filter was kept between the exposed limb and the light source to cut off infrared radiation. The potential and current generated by the system were measured by the digital pH meter and micrometer respectively. This is the experimental setup of our work. Now we discuss the result and discussion. First of all, we see the variation of photo potential with time in our system. Our system is toluidine blue, EDTA and NALS. Photocalvanic cell is placed in dark till it attains a stable potential and then in light. It was observed that the potential change on illumination and it reaches a constant value after a certain period. When the light source was removed, the direction of change in potential was reversed and a stable potential was again obtained after some time. We can see these in the graph. This is the stable potential. The stable potential value was obtained 1065 millivolt in 220 minutes. 220 minutes is a charging time of the cell. The dark potential was obtained 222 milliwatt, and the photo potential is the stable potential minus dark potential. The photo potential obtained 743 milliwatt. Variation of photo current with time. It was observed that there is a rapid rise in photo current on illumination and it reached a maximum within a few minutes. This maximum photocurrent is denoted by Imax. Then the current is found to decrease gradually with the period of illumination and reach a constant value at equilibrium. This equilibrium photocurrent denoted by IEQ. You can see in the graph, there is maximum photocurrent and equilibrium photocurrent. For toluidine blue EDTA NALS system, maximum photocurrent was obtained 150 microampere and equilibrium photocurrent was obtained 70 microampere. Now IV characteristic of the cell. The short circuit current ISC and open circuit voltage. Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Okay. This is the IV curve. Now we calculate the fill factor by using formula VPP IPP upon VOC and VOC. The value are shown in the slides. This is the performance of the cell. The performance of the cell is determined the half time of the power point. This is the conversion efficiency. There is a fill factor 0.367 and the conversion efficiency of our cell is 0.2630%. This is the parameters of our cell and that is the mechanism. Now we conclude the whole work. There is many techniques by which solar energy harness like photovoltaic cell, photogalvanic cell, but photovoltaic cell are cost effectively. The type of cell has an additional advantage of being used in dark due to its storage capacity. This type means photogalvanic cell. In developed photogalvanic cell, conversion efficiency and storage capacity are 0.2630% in 24 minutes. It means that is work in dark in 24 minutes. Anionic surfactant is more efficient than cationic and non-ionic surfactant. The effort is still.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. Please conclude.
Yes, ma'am. I am on conclude. The effort is still needed to enhance the electric output as well as storage capacity, along with the reduction in cost of photogalvanic cell by selecting suitable redox couple and reductants. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, I would Thank like to. Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to invite Dr. Ruthi S. Suruche. Jagruthi S. Suruche.
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Yes. To present Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Please, Jagrati, please present.
Yes, ma'am. Just a minute, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Just a minute, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. So 21 is here, 28, senior number 20, 26, 25, 24. They are present. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Mel, please continue in 5 minutes.
Yeah. I'm trying to present you, but don't know what is going on. But one minute.
Next in sequence, now I would like to invite Mr. Neelam Kumari. Kiran, K. Kiran Kumari is here.
Hello.
Yes, yes, hello. I'm here, Neelam.
Hello.
Neelam is here. Hello.
K. Kiran. K. Kiran Kumar is here.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, I'm Neelam Pajant here.
Okay.
You listen?
Yes, ma'am, you can present.
Serial number 24. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm going to present it now. Is my work visible? Is my PPT visible?
No, ma'am.
No.
Yes, ma'am. Your PPT is visible.
Is it visible now?
Yes,
yeah, ma'am. I think the internet wrong. Yes, sir. Should I start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Should I start? Yes. Okay. Yes. A very good afternoon, one and all. My name is Neelam. I am a PhD scholar, research scholar, pursuing my PhD on the topic of calcium urolithiasis from B&M University, Manipur, and Kerala, supervised by Dr. Narasimha, Professor of Chemistry, B&M University, Manipur, and Kerala. Today I am going to present my case study that is related to my thesis research work. The topic is studies on food habits of calcium urolithiasis patients in Kisangan district located in Bihar in India. Calcium urolithiasis is kidney stone disease. Kisangan district is Bihar is situated in the eastern part of India touching Nepal and Bangladesh border. Calcium urolithiasis or kidney stone disease is one of the most prevalent diseases in this region. Every year 19% male and 9% female suffer from this disease, and this region is the endemic belt in India. Various studies have been done and that shows that food habit is linked to this disease. So we decided to work on this. The methodology that we used A survey was conducted in different private clinics and hospitals located in the district with due permission from the physician, doctors and clinic owners. The patients of different age groups were provided with a well-structured questionnaire. The questionnaire contained questions related to their eating habits and some other general questions. The patients either filled themselves or in case of minor, their guardian were told to fill them. The result that we got, they mostly consumed animals' proteins like beef, pork, goat, chicken, and eggs. The cereal that they mainly included rice and wheat. They also had local fish like rohu, katla, rui fish, and prawn, etc. that were regular in their diet. A few people were vegetarians. So they mainly included spinach, tomato, onion, potato, sweet potato, etc. They loved the excessive use of tomato. During our finding, we got that they use a tomato curry almost every day. Besides curry, they also use it as a salad. Milk was consumed almost every day. Most of them were very fond of tea and generally included 4 cups a day. Young people loved fast food, soft drink, and fruit juices, mainly in this region, sugarcane juice, orange juices, etc. People also consumed alcohol. Besides, they added extra salt also in their diet. So the discussion. So because they used animal protein a lot, animal proteins are high in purine, a chemical substance which increases urinary calcium and uric acid. So it increases a calcium leakage in the urine as well as increases the uric acid level in the urine. It says that it decreases the pH level and it also decreases the citric acid in urine. Citric acid is a substance that helps in diluting the stones, preventing stone formation in the urine. So all these factors increase the formation of uric acid crystal, calcium oxalate crystal, and cysteine crystal. Tomato, spinach, beet, sweet potato, nuts, and tea that they regularly consume, they have high oxalic acid content, which causes calcium oxalate crystal formation. Fruit juices, which are mainly rich in vitamin C, and other sugary drinks, which are high in fructose, that are metabolized into oxalic acid and favors calcium oxalate crystal. If we include extra salt in their diet, then the sodium present in salt replaces calcium absorption by the kidney. So more calcium is released in urine, and which favors more stone formation. Tea and alcohols are known to be diuretic. This causes dehydration to a person and makes the urine more concentrated. And more concentrated urine leads to more stone formation. Besides that, alcohol also damages the functioning of kidney. And besides this food, we also found that the water in this area is hard water, and that also favors kidney stone disease. So after doing all that, we concluded that that certain food in diet is the main cause for a large number of kidney stone patients in this area, and also proved that there is a direct link between food habits and urolithiasis disease. So by replacing higher source of protein like animal protein with the lower source of protein like nuts, soya, etc., legumes, and limiting the intake of too much of salt, sugar, and aerated drinks, etc., the disease could be managed and controlled. So I hope that this finding will be helpful for the physician as well as to the local people of this region to assess the disease and to control the disease. I'm very thankful to the hospital and patient and clinic owner who helped me. I'm also very thankful to Professor TVRK Rao, principal, Mabekwal Kishanganj, who helped me doing all this work. And I'm very thankful to Department of Chemistry, GRM Rajasthan, for providing me with this opportunity to present my work here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Next, I would like to invite.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Hello. Thank you so much.
Ma'am, please. Ma'am, please, I would like to invite for the presentation.
Yes. Are you getting me?
Yes, ma'am.
Achha.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see the shared slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Deepti, for inviting me. Thank you. I congratulate Dr. Rakshit Ameta and his team of the Northern University for conducting such a innovative class for engaging such a fertile minds in this COVID time. It was highly required. So thank you so much, Amita sir, for inviting me for presenting my work here. Now we will start my topic, that is photocatalytic hydrogen generation, that is a clean fuel for green earth. That is my topic. My topic is already discussed by previous speakers like Deepa Madam and Savan sir, and so many speakers already discussed this topic. Especially I consider the name of Deepa Madam, who worked on water splitting, but they are focusing on electrolysis of water. But I will focus on photoelectrochemical and photocatalytic water splitting. First, we will go through the outline of the presentation. That presentation include the present energy scenario, SICM, that is hydrogen as an efficient fuel and energy carrier. So third, the sustainable energy way paths for hydrogen generation by water splitting. Fourth, that is photo-added water splitting by photoelectrochemical and photochemical methods, and criteria for photocatalytic selection of photocatalyst for water splitting. The ways of modification of photocatalytic material is also discussed in this presentation. Thirdly, the photoelectrochemical water splitting should be discussed in detail by using an example of tin film, that is with a CDSA quantum dot loaded zinc oxide nano rods and nano tubes. Thirdly, we will consider on photocatalytic water splitting, in which we discuss different type of materials like solid solutions, plasmonic nanocomposite materials, graphene oxide materials, and modified graphene oxides. And few dot oxide is also discussed in this presentation. First, we will discuss the present energy scenario in which we are getting our energy by using the conventional energy sources in a form of oil, coal, and gases, that is mostly in a form of carbon containing materials, and few very little amount of the renewable sources are considered as the energy sources, that is 13.1%. And when we look to the Humboldt-Bell plot, then we have already crossed over the oil content, highest oil content situation in 2007. Now we are in a downfall process of the energy contents of the whole world. So we should act very wisely to utilize our present conventional energy sources and replace these conventional energy sources with the renewable energy sources. What are the major deriving forces? These are the perpetual energy resource is wars among the countries. Secondly, the disturbs ecological balance of our earth, environmental pollutions, soaring price of fuels that we are observing very highly nowadays, global warming and their associated climate changes. These are also very prominent changes that we are observing nowadays. And when we are talking about the nuclear energy resources, then it is highly inexplicable to distinguish between the energy weapons and energy powers. We can't distinguish that the nuclear field will be utilized in making of nuclear weapons, or it will be utilized in making of nuclear power. So it is also restricted on this basis. Secondly, nextly, the abundantly and freely available energy, renewable energy sources are available. So we have to utilize it. There are so many renewable energy sources that nature provides freely without any cost. And most important, the consumer awareness, that is very important. Nowadays, the consumer is very, very, very aware, because it has he has so many platforms to get information. So our consumers are very aware nowadays. So in this present energy scenario, we have to have a good option as a clean and green energy resources. When we are thinking about the clean and green energy resources, then the hydrogen is the first name come to our mind, because when we go through the efficiency of the fuels, you can see the first column of this table, then we can compare the efficiency of the current gasolines, diesel and methyl fuels in compared to the hydrogen. Then we found the hydrogen is the most efficient fuel in comparison to the counter fuel available. When we are talking about the auto ignition temperature of the hydrogen, that is very high in comparison to the other gasoline products. It means it's quite stable. It is can't ignite quickly. It takes time. So it's the best thing for hydrogen. Now, when we are looking into the energy density of hydrogen, then we can see that is almost three times energy dense. Hydrogen is three times energy dense in comparison to the methane, gasoline, and diesels. When we're looking into the burning temperature of the gases, of the fuels, then it is almost same. So when we compare all these features with hydrogen, then we found that hydrogen is in win-win position. Why? And we add that to that hydrogen is clean, eco-friendly fuel. But because when we burn hydrogen, we are getting only water. Because, and without any greenhouse gases. When we are looking into the energy security, then it is also favorable for hydrogen, because in our planet, almost 95% contain hydrogen. So, and when we are looking to the energy security, the hydrogen is quite recommended. Thirdly, efficiency, we have already discussed that it is highest among its counter fuels. When we looking into the economic growth, so hydrogen can boost, when we replace hydrogen with the conventional fuels, then it will definitely boost our economic growth. So on this point, we can say hydrogen can be a better fuel options in comparison to the conventional available fuse. When we are looking for the hydrogen, so currently we are getting our hydrogen from methane streaming process. But when we are using methane for generating our hydrogen, then we are getting carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide as a side products. So we don't want these greenhouse gases in our environment. So we have to replace the resource. So we are going to replace that resource with water, that is very hydrogen rich substance. And then second question arises, how can we break water to get our hydrogen and oxygen? How can we get energy? So we have so many renewable energy options to break this water, such as wind energy, solar energy, hydro energy, geothermal energy, tidal energy, nuclear energy. These are all energy type that we can use for breaking of our water. But we have chosen solar energy for photolysis of water. For this, because sunlight is free of cost available, we are living in a Rajasthan region, so we are highly blessed with the solar energy. So therefore we have selected solar energy for supplying the energy to break the water. Then is it possible for the solar energy alone to break water? No. We have to utilize some materials along with solar energy to break water. What are these materials? These materials are basically semiconducting materials. When we are talking about the semiconducting materials, and when we show light to these semiconducting materials, then by getting this energy of solar energy, the valence band electron jump into the conduction band, and these conduction band electrons reduce water into hydrogen. When we are talking about the valence band holes, it will utilize in oxidizing water into oxygen. Then second question arises in our mind, can we use any semiconductor material for water splitting? No. Here, when we are considering the photocatalytic material, then we have to take care about the energy position of conduction band and valence band. Because when we are selecting our semiconducting material, then its conduction band position will much higher than the reduction potential of hydrogen, and that the oxidation potential of water, the valence band position of the semiconducting material should be much lower than this oxidation potential of water. So this semiconducting materials is wonderful materials which having both properties. We can reduce and oxidize water simultaneously using the semiconducting materials. If we are talking about the matters that can reduce the substance, when we are talking about the oxygen, it can reduce the material only. But when we are talking about the semiconducting material, so it has a beauty of reduction and oxidation the material simultaneously. So it's a preferable. Then when we are going considering the cleavage of water, then there are three prominent methods. One, the thermolysis, the second, the electrolysis, which focused by Deepa Madam yesterday, and third is a photo added matters. These photo added matters are photoelectrochemical water splitting. Second, the photocatalytic water splitting, photovoltaic water splitting, and these three processes are inspired by the nature. In nature, photosynthesis process is occurred that inspired to split water by using photocatalytic material. Here, when we are talking about the photo electrochemical water splitting, in which we have to use two electrodes. One is a working electrode, which is usually an anode material. Second is a counter electrode, that is a cathode electron rich material. And when we dip these two electrodes and plus supply some electricity, then we got splitting in water at anode. Oxygen is generated and hydrogen is generated at counter electrode. But here we are utilizing four factors. One, the semiconducting material. Second, the water. Third, the solar light. And the fourth feature is electricity. But if you don't want electricity, because electricity is basically generated from the conventional resources, so if you want to avoid this electricity, then we have to come to the photocatalytic water splitting, in which we mostly utilize the powder materials with water and sunlight. We need only three components for photocatalytic water splitting. The first one is water, second, the semiconducting material, and third, the solar light. By utilizing these three components, we can generate hydrogen and oxygen by the splitting of water. Then the next one is a photovoltaic process, in which we use tantalum electrodes for breaking of water and generating hydrogen and oxygen. Now we're focusing on the photo electrochemical water splitting and photocatalytic water splitting, because these processes are quite low costing methods and they have quite high solar to hydrogen efficiency, and most importantly, they have capacity to separate hydrogen and oxygen gas stream. They are, because both are gas, both of the gases are generated at different electrode. So we can collect these gases at these electrode sections. So we can separate these hydrogen and oxygen generated process. And these are the chemical reaction behind the oxidation of water by utilizing hole. It will have a requirement of potential -1.23 volts. Secondly, when we are considering the reduction reaction in which hydrogen is generated, then the potential requirement for this reaction is 0 volt. And the overall reaction required 1.23 volts. If we are considering the light part of solar light, then this range will be given in the IR region. So most important thing is, when we are considering the water splitting process, then it's energy uphill reaction. When we considering this plot, when we apply energy to break water into hydrogen and oxygen, then we require quite high energy. Then we are considering the second part, the
Hello, ma'am. Are you there? Hello, ma'am. Are you there? Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am, are you there?
Which ma'am you are calling? Please take the name of the madam.
Hello, Nilu ma'am. Hello, Nilu ma'am, are you there? Yes, sir. I think the connection is lost. Okay, sir. Now I would like to invite Mr. K. Kiran Kumar for the presentation. K. Kiran Kumar. K. Kiran Kumar, are you there? K. Kiran Kumar. K. Kiran Kumar. Okay, sir. Next in sequence, I would like to invite Nilanjana Kar for the presentation.
Yeah, I'm present.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Can you see my slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thanks. Is my voice clear?
Ma'am.
Shall yes, I start?
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thanks. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope all of you are in good health. However, when we don't feel we are in good health, the first thing that comes to our mind is to have proper medicines to address our health issues. A constant endeavor in research is devoted to deliver drugs in a convenient and efficient manner. Talking about convenience, if you see in this slide, there are different modes of drug delivery, out of which oral is the most convenient mode of drug delivery because of patient compliance. Now, for a drug to be orally active, it needs to be soluble. However, there are a huge number of drugs which have poor solubility. So the question arises, how do we deliver these poorly soluble drugs orally? Why isn't every drug a once-a-day small pill? Why can't oncology drugs and other IV formulations be converted to oral? The answer to all these questions is trying to find out a right delivery system, that is a right polymer that can do the magic. Herein comes the role of polysaccharides. We have chosen cellulose as it is the most abundant and completely natural polymer, which is a major component of all plants. From there, we had created cellulose esters derivatives. The cellulose esters will obviously have very low toxicity and very high stability. Additionally, it can form micro and nanoparticles thus making them suitable candidates for drug delivery formulation. The cellulose derivative that I synthesized is cellulose adipate. This is the structure of cellulose adipate, which provided an amorphous matrix that significantly enhanced the drug solubility by entrapping the drug in the metastable form. If you look closely at the structure, the molecule has a unique hydrophobic hydrophilic balance. The long carbon chain in blue, I have marked it, render hydrophobicity, and the pendant carboxylic acid group in red renders hydrophilicity to the molecule. The polymer was also designed to have a pH controlled release, which means the medication will not be released in the acidic environment of the stomach due to the presence of the pendant carboxylic acid group, which is marked in red in the compound. Once the tablet reaches the basic environment of the small intestine, there it will be released and will be absorbed in the bloodstream. Because of this unique hydrophobic hydrophilic balance, the polymer can also permit a zero order sustained release, which means the release rate of the drug stays constant over a period of 24 hours, reducing dosing frequency, that is just a once a day pill. So the synthesized cellulose adipate can form an amorphous solid dispersion, which in turn can be converted into nanoparticles, subsequently increasing the bioavailability of poorly soluble drugs. Now coming to the challenging part of synthesizing the cellulose adipate. First, of course, I tried the straightforward way of reacting cellulose with adipic anhydride to form the cellulose adipate ester. However, the reaction resulted in forming a viscous gel, which was not soluble in any solvent, including DMSO. Since it was not soluble in any solvent, I had to go for solid state 13C NMR, and IR spectroscopy additionally confirmed the formation of a cross-linked cellulose adipate. And no wonder it was not soluble in any solvent because of its huge molecular weight, a polymer, and apart from that, it's being cross-linked also. So definitely the synthetic strategy needed to be changed because we are looking for a water dispersible cellulose derivative for oral drug delivery purposes. After a lot of efforts, we found out a novel approach where the starting material was partially derivatized cellulose ester, and it was reacted with benzyl adipoyl chloride to give the benzyl cellulose adipate. So this is the benzyl cellulose adipate where the cursor is. And finally, and over here you see the carboxylic acid group is capped. So to uncap it, we did a hydrogenation reaction to get the free carboxylic acid group over here at the end, the free carboxylic acid group. So in conclusion, I can say we successfully synthesized cellulose adipate derivatives, which helped the medicine reach to the target. The API or the drug used for this study was ritonavir, which is a poorly soluble HIV drug. These are my references. And finally, I would like to thank my postdoc supervisor, Professor Kevin Edgar, Virginia Tech, USA, Srimati CHM College, where I'm currently working, and of course, JR and Rajasthan Vidyapeeth for giving me an opportunity to deliver on this platform. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for sharing your reflective knowledge with us. Now, this is time to encourage the spirit of next researcher. For that, I would like to invite Ms. Seema Kothari, ma'am. Seema Kothari, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Please present, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, screen is visible.
हाँ सर, मेरा कितना हो पाया था? हाँ, मैं तो इसी में हूँ. हाँ, तो कितना हो पाया था? अच्छा, ओके ओके, ठीक है. मतलब कितना हो पाया था बताइए ना. अच्छा ओके ठीक है क्योंकि क्या है कि मेरा पता नहीं क्यों ब्रेक हो रहा है बीच में.
दीप्ति मैम.
यस मैम यू आफ्टर
कैन स्टार्ट और
नो मैम ओके नीलू मैम वांट टू मैम स्टार्ट.
ओके ओके
मैम
हेलो
हेलो हां यस मैम प्लीज हेलो
हां दीप्ति मैम आर यू गेटिंग मी.
यू कैन स्टार्ट मैम.
ओके थैंक
यू. यस मैम.
ओके तो आई विल कंटिन्यू फॉर द स्लाइड्स. ओके वेयर वी आर. ओके थैंक यू सो मच एंड सॉरी फॉर इंटरप्शन.
इट्स ओके मैम.
ओके थैंक यू सो मच. या सो दीज आर द डिफरेंट मोड्स. बाय यूजिंग दीज मोड्स वी कैन मॉडिफाई अवर फोटोकैटालिटिक मटेरियल्स means by nano structuring some sensitization of materials because we are using oxides because they are quite stable in sunlight and water but they have one drawback that they can't harvest the full light fully so therefore we need to sensitize these oxide materials by utilizing dyes either dyes or quantum dots. So these are the case that used to increase the efficiency of the water splitting process. And one more important technique to increase the efficiency is band gap engineering, in which either we can dop the semiconducting material with the donor metals, in which we can modify the conduction band sites, either. We can add the soft metals means lightweight elements like carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur. In that way, we can modify the conduction band side of the photocatalytic materials. In that way, we can modify the band gap and make our photocatalytic to harvest the larger part of the light and to enhance the efficiency of water splitting process. In that way, one more method is very quite important, that is making of solid solution, in which we are taking two kind of materials. One is a wide band gap material, second is a narrow band gap materials, and we mix these two materials to get our solid solutions for reducing with reduced band gap. So in that way we can make band gap engineering, and this is the first method that we utilize on our materials. This is the photo electrochemical water splitting by utilizing the cadmium selenide loaded zinc oxide thin films by using zinc oxide nanotubes and nanorods. Here these are the few examples in which we have synthesized the nanorads of zinc oxides. Here is a epipixel and aerial view of these nanorods, and we convert these nanorods by etching with ammonium hydroxide into the nano zinc oxide nanotubes. Here you can see the lateral view of these nanotubes. So we can convert. We converted these nanorods into nanotubes by using this ammonium hydroxide and utilize these materials to develop the photo anodes. In that way, this is a stochastic development of the photo anode, in which first we take the FTO materials, in which we develop some seeds of zinc, then we grow zinc oxide nanotubes and nanorods. We then sensitize these nanorods and nanotubes with sensitizer, that is cadmium selenide. Then we anneal this cadmium selenide loaded zinc oxide nanotubes and nanorod, and make this, after making these photo anodes, we apply these anodes in this photoelectrochemical cell, where here you can see there are two electrodes. One is a photoelectrode, that is a working electrode, that is basically anode material, and second is a platinum material. Here, this, because we are taking semiconducting material as a photoelectrode, so when we show the light to this photo catalyst, then the electron jump, you can clearly see, from valence band to the conduction band, and this electron move through the bias to the cathode material, which is electron already electron bridge, and these electrons will work with water to generate hydrogen. Here you can see, yeah, hydrogen is generated. And the holes left at the valence band side will react with water. These holes reacted with water, OH part of the water, and generate oxygen. Here, yeah, the oxygen liberated. So water is splitting the whole water is splitting is happen in this photoelectrochemical technique. These are the results of photovoltaic study of our material. So we can see that the advancements of material will enhance the water splitting capacity in terms of the photo current density. Okay, you can see pristine show zinc oxide nanorods show very little amount of photocurrent density. When we loaded with that sensitizer, it enhanced further. When we anneal this sample, then it will enhance further. And when we replace these rods with nanotubes, then we are getting almost two times higher water is splitting in comparison to the zinc nanorod electrodes, photoelectrodes. So it's a quite interesting study. Second case we will take it, that the photocatalytic water is splitting, in which we will take the powder semiconducting material, water and sunlight for breaking of water. So here we are discussing some examples. In this process, we are going to engineer the band gap, either by doping cation, anion, or by making solid solution. All three examples will come later on. Here it is an example of cobalt doped, that is a metal, means it will rectify the conduction band, valence band side, conduction band side of the semiconductor. Okay, and reduce the band gap. Okay, this is a process, and we are getting these kind of nanorods. And this is the, this A, B, C, D, these are the nanostructures which can show that the effect of the increasing surfactant in modifying the shape of the zinc oxide, cobalt loaded zinc oxide nanomaterials. Here we can see there is a gradual changing in a shape from that propylated size of the nanorods to the that flat zinc oxide nanorods. So for this particular study, we have used that 40% CTAB surfactant case in which we are getting that kind of flat aged zinc oxide rods. Utilize them for photocatalytic water splitting, and you can see that the result of the hydrogen generation, we are not considering here the photoelectron density as a water splitting parameter. Here we are considering here the hydrogen generation as a water splitting criteria. Okay, why only hydrogen? Because we restrict this water splitting by utilizing the whole consuming sacrificial electrolyte, that is the sulfate sulfide combination. So this electrolyte material consume holes, so only electrons are available for water, and these electrons will definitely reduce water into hydrogen. And these are the efficiency. You can see that when we are loading our material with the cobalt, the efficiency become double. That is apparent quantum yield become double, almost double. When we loaded this substance with a sensitizer, then again it will increase by more than three times. So it's a gradual modification of the system will enhance the efficiency of water splitting. So this paper is published in International Journal of Hydrogen Energy in 2016. Second, solid solution, we have already taken one example. We have synthesized this system by using germanium nitrate and zinc oxide. These are the two basic components, and by utilizing these two basic components, we have generated this system, zinc germanium oxynitrites. And we loaded this zinc germanium oxynitrate to enhance the efficiency. We loaded this compound with the cadmium. Okay, and you can see the loading of cadmium on zinc germanium oxynitrate compound, and you can also see the loading of the co-catalyst here, ruthenium and chromium oxide. We are utilizing as a co-catalyst material, and this is the electrochemical mechanism for hydrogen generation. This is the structure that we get by utilizing different analytical technique on our material in the form of Zanis. We have performed five Zanis experiment along the cadmium KH, oxygen KH, nitrogen KH, germanium KH, and zinc KH, and they are able to get this structure for our material. And here in this material, the two bridging materials are there in form of oxygen and nitrogen, and one cavity is generated for electrostatic repulsion, attraction of this water. This electrostatic attraction attract water molecule in to combine with this moiety, and that Bronsted at this side, this water molecule will attach in form of hydrogen, and rest of the part of water means OH molecules are attached to the cadmium side. And again, because this hydrogen is electropositive side, so therefore one more water molecule come to this hydrogen molecule, react, and because it become bulky, so it will remove in form of H3O plus ions, that will further dissociate into H2O and H plus ion. These H plus ion react with electrons that generated at the conduction side and generate hydrogen. This is a whole about the mechanism, how hydrogen is generated. And this is the efficiency, you can see in terms of hydrogen generation. So you can observe that the samples in the size at 600. We have already also make variation in temperature, synthesis temperature, to get optimum efficiency, efficient material. And we got that the 600 degrees Celsius annealed sample show the maximum efficiency in terms of hydrogen production. Next material is plasmonic material. I suppose you all are familiar with the plasmonic materials, in which I will just short them. Okay, so this these are the plasmonic material that we utilize for enhancing the efficiency of our oxide materials, because when the small size 10 nanometers, say we small size nanoparticles will expose with the light, then due to the surface plasmonic resonance, that energy area is generated like that, the red area. Okay, due to this energy area, this material become more active. Here, this is an example in which we have generated nano lotus composite materials, and in which silver and zinc metals are used as a plasmonic materials. And here, one more important phenomena, that is a self-sensitization, was observed in this material. It is also very good for water splitting. This is another example in which we have loaded our oxide, cerium oxide material with gallium, and it show quite good efficiency for water splitting. I suppose you can go through our paper. It's recently published in a global challenges, and this is a water hydrogen production rate in minimoles. It's quite high in comparison to the zinc metals. This is a mechanism. This is another material. Now, yeah, it's quite interesting. The graphene oxide materials, that, and we reduce these graphene oxide materials by ascorbic acid and lemon, and we find that the graphene oxide that we have reduced from lemon show quite enhanced properties in terms of water splitting and magnetism. Magnetism is not made for the carbon compound, but we are getting magnetism in our synthesis system, super magnetism in this system. So that's why this paper is published in ACS Applied Energy Material. We are not only getting good magnetism for these materials, but we are getting good photocatalytic water splitting for this material also. These are some parameters in which we can say the our material is working quite fine in comparison to the state of art zinc graphene oxide and reduced graphene oxide materials. This is another system that we are working on. We have loaded our graphene oxide material with the nickel phosphate, and this is a structure, probable structure, and this is the water splitting mechanism for this particular material, and these are the hydrogen production rate for this material. It showing that the material that having 0.5% zinc oxide loaded nickel phosphate showing the maximum efficiency for hydrogen generation in 3 hours time interval. So these are quite efficient systems. So I suppose we have discussed so many systems and a lot of materials we have synthesized in our lab by help of our research scholars, Rajesh, Niranjan, Neeta, Kayakal Shah, Amanish, and Dipali. these are working for us. So I thankful for my students who worked a lot for me and my collaborators who perform analysis for us. And from these words, I thank audience for giving kind attention to my lecture. And I will rest my verse with these lines. The all darkness in this world can't extinguish the light that ignite from the single candle. So be a candle and spread the light in this universe and dispel the darkness of the world. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for sharing your deep knowledge with us. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Next in sequence, now I would like to invite Seema Kothari, ma'am, for the presentation.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Please present, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, it is audible or visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. I, Dr. Seema Kothari, today present synthesis, characterization, and biological activity of some substituted thiazolidinone-based heterocyclic derivatives. Thiazoles are five-membered heterocyclic compounds that contain both nitrogen and sulfur. The derivatives of thiazoles are shows various pharmacological activities like antibacterial, antitubercular, antifungal, antimicrobial, K+, etc. The incorporation of carbonyl group in thiazole ring increase its pharmacological activity. For this purpose, we synthesize some substituted thiazolidinone derivative. For this purpose, first we prepare alpha beta unsaturated chalcone systems. For this preparation of chalcones, we use benzaldehyde or parahydroxyacetophenone. In the presence of NaOH, they form chalcone system. When these chalcone system treated with hydrazine in acetic acid, they form pyrazolone derivatives are designated as first. When these pyrazolone derivatives are treated with different substituted aniline, they form shift base. Here we use five type of substituted aniline, so we prepare second A2E substituted shift base. When this shift base are treated with mercaptosuccinic acid in DMF and pinch of zinc chloride, they form different substituted thiazolidinone derivatives. This thiazolidinone derivatives data in table 2 and table 1 contain physical data of pyrazolones. All the synthesized compounds are confirmed their structure by their IR, NMR, mass, and elemental analysis. For here, we present only one compound. It gave IR spectrum. The aromatic stretching band occurs at 3076 centimeter inverse. Carbonyl group of thiazolone shows at 1736, same as N double bond CH group shows at 1637, C double bond N shows 1600, and carbon-carbon double bond shows 1511, and CCl bond shows absorption at 749 centimeter inverse. The nature of the proton shows is identified by the NMR spectrum. The proton NMR spectrum shows a double doublet for pi one proton of pyrazolone ring shows 3.392, 3.43, and a doublet of thiazole proton shows at 3.912, 3.96, and the aromatic proton shows multiplied at 7.1, 7.86, and a doublet shows for CH2 group nearby carboxylic group at 2.89, and a methoxy group proton shows singlet at 3.79. In the mass spectrum, the M plus ion peak at 569, and a base peak observed at 493. And next fragment shows different peaks at there according to M by Z value. The IR spectrum of synthesized compounds, third C. NMR spectrum.
Sorry to interrupt you, ma'am. Include in time, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. And mass spectrum, all the synthesized compounds were screened for their biological activity for gram positive and gram negative bacteria. From the synthesized compound, we conclude that when compound has electron withdrawing group, they shows weak activity as compared to control, and when compound has electron donating group, it has greater activity against S. aureus, E. coli, S. subtilis, etc. So we can conclude by their concentration that electron donating groups are more active as compared to their control system like ciprofloxacin. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to invite Ms. Nisha Garg for the presentation.
Nisha, yes, ma'am, I'm ready. Yes, ma'am, I'm ready.
Okay.
Good afternoon to all of you. Just a minute, please. Am I visible, ma'am? My slides are visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yes. My topic is replace toxic chemical with sustainable plant parts in quantitative analysis using green chemistry. A qualitative analysis of an organic mixture is an important part of laboratory curriculum, and classical method of analysis involve use of large quantity of corrosive acid in various toxic chemicals, which generate considerable amount of liquid waste, which contaminate the nearby bodies, as well as heating of these hazardous chemical generate noxious fumes, which deteriorate the surrounding air quality also. The current study involved the use of only part of plants, which being eco-friendly are a better alternative than these deadly chemicals. Green chemistry is defined as invention, design, development and application of chemical product and process to reduce to eliminate the use and generation of substance hazardous to human health and environment. Applying the 12 principles of green chemistry into the practice will eventually help to pave the way to a world where the practice is greener. In green chemistry, function is not related to hazard, making safe and non-toxic product, and process is the goal. Our work is successfully approach to apply green chemistry and sustainable energy in laboratory and also the surrounding environment. Our objective is to conceptualize the practice of green chemistry and sustainability in education. The need of the hour is to ensure a safe and stress-free chemistry laboratory for students, teachers, and supporting staff. This was the focal point in the innovative project. Now the methodology is that qualitative analysis of unknown inorganic and organic mixture is an important part of chemistry curriculum at the school, undergraduate and postgraduate level in India and all over the world. Our study focused on the simple chemistry lab experiment that involved the identification of cation, anion, element and functional group via given reagent as a sample from plants, different plants parts. Qualitative analysis of inorganic and organic compounds with the help of different parts of Clateria taenata plants, and the observation is based on the color genes. This plant, commonly known as blue pea, butterfly pea, belongs to the family Fabaceae. It is very commonly found in India and Asia and Africa. Now, this is how to prepare the sample. Sample preparation of flower, leaf and root extract. That simple procedure is there. Plant parts are crushed and then boiled in water to get their extract. As we know that water is a universal solvent, so we use it, and it is there is no harm for this. Now, qualitative analysis table, which we analyze the cation, anion, element and the functional group. First, I will relate this first to anion, that is chloride, sulfate, next, phosphate, sulfide, lead ion, and the cations are lead ions, which are present to all the three parts of the plant, that is the root, leaf and the flower also. Then, copper, iron, and chromium and the cobalt and the zinc, which are the simple tests, and the manganese and the barium also present in the all three parts of the plant. And the third is the third part, calcium, and in group six test magnesium, next nitrogen. So the element test as in our an organic analysis, qualitative analysis, we perform the elemental analysis, functional group test also. First we apply for element, that is nitrogen test, sulfur test, and then chlorine test, then carboxylic, and in the functional group we apply carboxylic group, phenolic group, alcoholic group, and carbonyl group, and ketonic group, and sample plus ethanol and dinitrophenyl hydrazine we used in this reaction aldehyde group, and the carbohydrate, and then ester analysis, and the last two are amines and nitro group and amide group. Now what is the result? I have to explain result and discussion in one semester. About 15 laboratory sessions are devoted to mixture analysis, and three section of the student, about total 180 student per year, performed this. This indicated a very high level of consumption of chemicals, an enormous amount of waste in comparison the amount of chemical used in the conventional and the green method of analysis for a laboratory of 60 student is shown in table. Thus, here we see the in table, the in conventional method, the huge amount of the chemical are used, while in the modified method, only few amount of the chemical we used as a plant extract for the analysis, and only few as a reagent, there are few amount of chemicals are needed. Result and designing green and sustainable experimentation in lab and classroom is a central demand to make chemistry interesting, attractive and environmentally benign. The conventionally incorporated method in all educational study plans from primary school to university have a problem that they have terrible environmental impact that increase the bad tenure of practical chemistry. On the other hand, the green practice solve the problem through simplicity, usage of less material, safety during the processor. Presence of the high environmental impact in the green processor, material and the liquid chemical waste was minimized. The environmental impact was high, and the student clearly understand the meaning of green chemistry and sustainability in practice. So in last, we conclude, I want to conclude this. This scheme for qualitative analysis need no special equipment or instrument and may be carried out in any UG, PG or even school laboratory. The procedure has been used by UG, PG students and the results are consistent and reproducible. A couple of years back, one could find a way to our chemistry lab due to the fumes of various gases and smell of H2S. But now after the greening of these lab exercise, ambience of our chemistry lab has greatly improved. The scheme is relatively hazard-free and is a step towards introduction of green practice to young students. The work has clearly conceptualized the practical meaning of green chemistry and the sustainability in education. The green procedure is advantageous and takes superiority over the conventional one. Also, it can be applied to wide variety of lab experimentation. with the mission of promote greening of chemical education. The study has opened research window to encourage benign and sustainable research on educational practice and to activate the embedding green chemistry and sustainability practice in study plans of all education level. There are the references.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you to all. Thanks to all organizing committee to give the so nice platform and give this a nice opportunity to present over here. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Now I would like to invite Poonam Punia for the presentation. Poonam, are you there?
Hello. Yeah, ma'am, I'm ready.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Six. No, sir.
Hello.
Remaining, okay, sir. Six, sir.
Yes, yes, I'm there.
Hello.
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 Okay. So, next, I would like to invite Poonam Punia for the presentation.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. May I start?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. I'm presenting. Just presenting, ma'am. Hello, is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Poonam Punia, Assistant Professor from the Department of Geology, Jain Iron Vyas University, Jodhpur. My presentation topic is Treatment of Acid Mine Drainage by Biochar, a New Sustainable Approach. As we know, mining is one of the most important industrial activity in India and is a major economic activity which contributes significantly to the economy of India. But along with this, it also causes major serious environmental problem in form of acid mine drainage. This problem of acid mine drainage has been present since mining activities began thousands of years ago. The problem is associated with metal mining, but mainly with the coal mining. The toxicity about acid mine drainage is its low pH and the high concentration of dissolved heavy metal and sulfur. Now, how the formation of acid mine drainage takes place? The rocks of coal minerals are associated with pyrites and sulfide minerals. During mining activities, these minerals, that is pyrites and sulfides, these are exposed to air and water, causes oxidation and hydrolysis, and these reactions form sulfuric acid and dissolved iron. This is called acid mine drainage. Acid mine drainage is problem of both active mine as well as abandonment mines. Now, the environmental problem caused by acid mine drainage. Acid mine drainage is highly acidic and thus toxic. By seepage, leaching, and with rainwater, it contaminated groundwater, surface water, and ultimately the soil biota. This causes threat to the flora, fauna, and through food chain, it enters to the human being. This is a picture of acid mine drainage. It seems look like as a red, yellow, orange river which is flowing, and it is also called as a yellow ball. Now, what is the treatment of acid mine drainage? Due to such a hazardous effect, it is very important to solve out this worldwide problem. The main treatment methodology are of two types. One is active and second is passive treatment. Active treatment is just the addition of chemical compounds so to precipitate the metal ions to enhance the pH. This involves precipitation, oxidation, alkali additions, etc. And the passive treatment includes the combination of some biological as well as chemical medium to overcome the acid mine drainage problem. And this includes the wetlands, open limestone channels, etc. All this treatment technology includes high operating, maintenance cost, and long-term input, etc. The one of the promising technology that needs low operation and maintenance and receiving considerable attention is the treatment with biochar. Biochar is a cheap, natural resource that effectively addresses the management of acid mine drainage by increasing the pH and immobilization of the metal ions of the acid mine drainage. Biochar is produced by the thermal decomposition of the organic material under a limited supply of oxygen at a very low temperature. This biochar is a carbon-rich material which is then used for the acid mine drainage treatment. Biochar is produced from various feedstocks such as agriculture biomass, such as rice husk, wheat husk, bagasse, also from the even green waste, paper products, animal manures, that is cow dung, solid sludge, etc. Biochar through precipitation, complexation, ion exchange, physical sorption mechanism overcome the high concentration of matter and low pH. One important characteristic of biochar is that pH of biochar is strongly alkaline, and also due to the high surface area and pores, it effectively adsorbs the metal ion and enhance the pH of the acid mine drainage. Here are some case studies that show effectiveness of biochar. Whether the biochar is of poultry litter or of wood bark or even the sludge, all are very effective in absorbing high concentration of metal ions. Even the some reportings, as we can see, it is up to about 98% heavy metals such as copper, zinc, iron, nickel, magnesium, etc. Now, finally, conclusion is that biochar as a low-cost adsorbent, it is a new sustainable approach of treatment of acid mine drainage by increasing the pH and by and absorbing the various heavy metals in the acid mine drainage. Thanks to all for the patience hearing, and I want to thank the organizers for giving me opportunity of the presentation. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to invite next in sequence Pramod B. Thakur sir. Mr. Pramod B.
Thakur. Yes, yes. Yes, ma'am. I'm starting.
Okay. Sir, please present fast.
Yes, yes. So it is visible? I have started sharing. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So myself, Dr. Pramod Thakur, serial number 30, I am going to present a paper entitled Choline Chloride Urea and Efficient Reaction Media for the Synthesis of 3-hydroxyoxyindole Scaffolds Using Henry Reaction. So basically, what is Henry Reaction? It is a base catalyzed carbon-carbon bond forming reaction between nitroalkane and aldehydes or ketone, which is also known as a nitroaldone reaction. This reaction has been utilized for the synthesis of 3-hydroxy-3-nitroalkyloxyindoles by reaction of nitroalkanes with isatine. So this is basically the framework for which I am talking about. And this framework not only have an interesting molecular architecture, but also have a densely functionalized core and exhibit significant bioactivity. So this framework is a 3-nitroalkyl substituted 3-hydroxyoxyindole, which have been explored as an important precursor in the synthesis of natural product and biological active molecule. These are some representative examples in which this framework have been utilized. So these are the literature survey of my reaction in which the isatine and nitroalkanes have been treated under different reaction conditions to offer this desired product. This reaction have been explored in various reaction conditions, and each of the reaction conditions have its own demerits and as well as merits. So to avoid the demerits and the make reaction more efficiently, what we have planned a new method. This new method includes the use of DES, that is deep eutectic solvent. So we have prepared the choline chloride urea based DES. The preparation involved reaction of choline chloride 1 mole with urea 2 mole at 74 degrees centigrade till a clear solution was obtained, which was used reaction without any purification. So here is the detailed procedure. To a solution of isatine 1 millimole in choline chloride urea based DES NML was added a nitroalkane 2 millimole. The reaction mixture was stirred at room temperature for stipulated time, which is 20 minutes. After the complete consumption of acetin as indicated by the TLC, the reaction mixture was filtered to obtain the crude solid product. The residue was dried, purified by column chromatography, and subjected for structure elucidation. The filtrate, which was obtained after the filtration, we can collect the DS, which can be dried by applying vacuum, and it can be used in the next reaction. So this is the characterization spectral data, which is known as the H1NMR for the desired compound. This is the required compound, which was expected by synthesized by using the DS. Here the characterization peak, which is this quaternary hydroxy, can be clearly seen at this 6.58 broad singlet, which indicate the presence of this quaternary hydroxy group. Here is a C13 spectrum, which this quaternary carbon can be easily identified in a C13, which is present at this 78.7 ppm. Further, this mass, which is a ESI mass, which shows the peak at 231, which is M plus NF piece. This is the characteristic peaks of this particular compound, which is reflect that this compound is synthesized. And this is the some FTIR spectrum of this compound, which shows the characteristic peaks of this structure, which include the nitro group, hydroxy group, this amide linkage. So all these peaks are related to this particular molecule. So the characterization data indicate that this compound can be efficiently synthesized by using this DS as a efficient reaction media. Here are the substrate scope of my method, in which I have prepared various compounds utilizing this developed method within a very short period of time. We can see here that some of the compounds were obtained in high diastereoselective yield without using any chiral mediator or any chiral catalyst. So just by using this reaction media, we can complete the reaction within a short reaction of time. Here is the mechanism of this reaction, in which, as we know, that nitroalkane, which contain the acidic hydrogen having the pKa nearly 9, can be easily abstracted by the mild basic condition, which is generated by this choline chloride urea based DS. So it forms an anion, and that anion can be effectively attacked by this carbonyl group of this acetin, and it forms a complex which can be resulted into the formation of desired product. So this way, without using any catalyst or any basic medium, we can proceed the reaction just by using this eutectic solvent. Here are the highlights of this developed method. It is a green synthesis using DS as a solvent or mediator, require no additional catalyst or additive, wide scope of substrate, short reaction time, high yield of desired product, avoidance of aqueous workup extraction step. This is very important from green chemistry point of view. Mild reaction condition, which is working at a room temperature, and very important is that a high diastereoselectivity without using any chiral mediator or chiral catalyst. So the conclusion of my paper is that we demonstrated an efficient Henry reaction of variety of acetyls with a nitroalkane in choline chloride urea based DS at room temperature to afford desired product 3-hydroxy, 3-nitroalkyl oxyindol in very good to excellent yield, mild reaction condition, high yield, and wide scope. The distinct feature of our protocol, application of this work will be, this protocol may find utility in the synthesis of new natural products and biologically important hydroxyoxyindol analogs under mild reaction condition, and the future scope will be that this method may find application for the synthesis of various natural products, which is named here, like horsafine, cellulosecans, pyroprasin, and the preparation of biologically important library of molecule, which may be desirable for the bioimmunological study. So I conclude my paper here, and I thanks to organizer for giving me opportunity to present my work in your esteemed conference. Thanks a lot to all.
Thank you so much, sir. Next, I would like to invite R. Kalyawani. Are you there? Sir, 5.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you so much, sir. Now, I would like to invite you, Mr. R. Kalyamani. Are you there, sir? R. Kalyamani. In sequence, Dr. Jagriti S. Susho, Dr. Jagriti. Dr. Jagruti S. Susho. Next, K. Kiran Kumar. K. Kiran Kumar. Hello. K. Kiran Kumar.
Madam, my PPT is got corrupted, madam. Please skip on this, madam, please.
Okay. Neha Kapoor is there. Neha Kapoor. Neha Kapoor is there. Vagela Forum H. Miss. Hello. Anyone there?
Serial number 39 is available, ma'am. Hello?
19 to 30 serial number. Anyone is present? Serial number 19 to 30.
My number is 39.
No, sir.
Okay.
Anyone 1 to 30 want to present? Okay, sir.
Excuse me, ma'am. Could I please get the feedback link?
Ma'am, do you have the same link for tomorrow also?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes,
sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. Ma'am, please provide second session serial feedback form.
Serial number 1 to 30, anyone is there? Six number, Ajmal Rishi, is there? Seven, Hitendra S. Joshi. Hitendra S. Joshi. Eight, Mathur Neha. 14, serial number 14, Sharma Bhaveshar. 16, serial number 16 are there. Serial number 17. Serial number 17, Devangana Das. Anyone there? Over, sir. If anyone is present from serial number 1 to 30 and want to present the session or presentation, please present.
Yes, sir.
Feedback pen is not open, sir.
Yes.
Serial number 6, serial.
Yes, it is working.
Hello. I think I should repeat the serial number. Anyone is there?
Hello.
Jagruti as Susho. Sir, Jagruti as Susho is present there.
Hello.
Hello, Dr. Jagruti as Susho. Are you present, ma'am?
Hello.
Hello. Please present your. Hello. Please present. Please present, ma'am. Jagruti as Susho. Sir, I think she is gone. I am repeating all the serial numbers. If anyone is present, please present serial number 6, serial number 7, serial number 8, serial number 14, serial number 16, serial number 17, serial number 19, serial number 21, serial number 22, serial number 23, and serial number 29. If anyone is there, please present. Sir, K. Kiran Kumar is there? Hello, sir.
Yes, ma'am. I'm not presenting because PPT okay. is corrupted, madam.
Okay.
I sent the abstract, but PPT is got corrupted.
Okay,
sir. It's not supporting.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you all the participants who present Hello. Very nicely in the session.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
And thanks, everyone.
बाजूला एनजीएस बिल्डिंग मध्येच आहे, चिक बिल्डिंग आहे ना छोटी छोटी, प्रत्येक ठिकाणचे वेगळा काहीतरी नियम असेल आपल्याला काय माहिती ते काय ठरवलं असेल महाराष्ट्र
Thank you.